Shalom, this your boy Big Truck here at the King's Table. Coming right back at you with part three of Men's Conversation. So we're going to dive into this one, have some talking points, and have my final thoughts. And we're going to bring this thing home. It is so positive and so good, keeping that energy, that masculine, positive, fruitful energy going on with the conversation amongst men at the table, just getting it in, getting down to the root, having those deep discussions.
Relationship-wise, because sometimes it isn't in our homes, right? Sometimes it's relationships we may see, even on TV, you know what I'm saying, or just in community. Like, what was the thing that was like, oh, like, I actually believe this can happen?
I mean, definitely, I would give it to my parents. For me, my parents and my grandparents, I grew up seeing, like, my parents are married, my grandparents, I grew up seeing love, but my love was tainted because of, like, you know, all my mom, my dad issues. They, you know, they got married young, and they was together for a long time, so it got tainted. Like, me being the oldest son, I was like, yo, like, I loved seeing them in love, but it's a lot of bad times with it, you know? And when you the kid and the oldest, sometimes you're like, yo, I think I'm better by myself.
Yeah, you're also wearing some of that, like, friction.
Definitely wearing it, you know, definitely wearing it. But it's crazy because I feel like watching them all these years, the way they love each other now, I feel like they the most in love that I've ever seen. Mm-hmm. So it makes me pay attention and like, yo, it was worth them sticking it out.
Hearing this brother share his testimony, I'm quite sure a lot of men experience the same thing. You know, as a child, you see some things. That's why I always share with parents, be careful of what you do around your children, because they are tape recorders. The things that they see, they're going to pick up those habits. So the brother was saying that he's seen his parents go through it. The challenges of being a married couple. And because he's seen those challenges, kind of made him feel a certain type of way. Or when it comes to relationships, I want to operate in this way. Because growing up, I've seen my parents operate in that way. And that's the wrong way. But overall, seeing how they stuck it out, man, that's teamwork. Because, again, when you're married, life is going to hand you things. Life is going to happen. But it's how you handle the storm.
...100% happy with each other.
Yeah.
Even when they argue, they still happy. It's different. It's weird. It's creepy a little bit when you're the kid. You know what I'm saying?
I love it.
It's interesting. So for me, when I knew I was in love, I was like my boy. Like I was like, man, I don't need that. I'm in LA. I'm about to get, you know what I'm saying? I was feeling all that. And my girlfriend, you know what I'm saying, Tanisha, she basically was like, you don't think you need love. Like, you really don't think you need love, and that's why I'm here. And I just was like, what? Like it was weird. Like, yo, why are you telling me? Like, how you know that? Like, how you know that? But she was like, you really don't think you need love, and that's a big problem. Because we tell ourselves, especially out here, I don't even think it's an L.A. thing. I think it's a young person thing. We be like, you know, we get caught up on success so much.
Yeah.
And we put success before love. But I think these days, it's hand in hand. Like, that's the most, when you find both, that's when you really, truly find happiness.
You have that teammate. Your teammate is going to push you. Your teammate is going to motivate you. Your teammate is going to work with you. Your teammate is not going to abandon you nor leave you. Your teammate is going to cover you, going to pray for you, pray with you, make sure you're good. When you come home from a hard day's work, she got a plate of food ready for you because she know you've been at work all day. Babe, I miss you. Boom. So oftentimes we neglect that as men. And it can happen sometimes. We neglect the things that we really do need. But we put focus on the things that we want and neglect what we need, if that makes sense.
Cherish every moment we have been given.
Yeah, I think success is love, man. Same similar story with you, you know, I was baptized in love. Like, my family just kind of corralled around us, you know? But I also was an observant child, and I looked at my parents and realized they're people at a certain age, and was able to kind of like dissect them and, you know, kind of take a vantage point of saying like, okay, like, you know, love doesn't hurt, people hurt. Like, love is pure, love is perfect. It travels through us, right? Like, we channel it, but it's traveling through a flawed system. So if you imagine like water traveling through a pipe that's dirty, like the residue that the water extracts, right, that it has on it, it's like how we kind of give love. So if you're, the more tainted you are, the more like, you know, trauma you had as a child, you're gonna love like that. Usually, that's not always the case. Mm. So when that's passed around, you're given something that you don't really know how to receive, right? And there's this thing about love that's reciprocal, and you made so many good points where, you know, like, love is going, it's again, it's all consuming. There's nothing else that can exist when that thing is there, right? It's not even conditional. Like, I don't love my wife because anything.
Nothing's more
except
powerful.
That she is. She doesn't love me except the fact that I am. That's it. Yeah. It's not because I do this, because I am.
Because of, not in spite of.
Because of, because I breathe, yeah. Right? So, and I love her because she breathes, right? And when you fall on that, at the end of the day, is your foundation, man, you could get through anything.
Anytime. I have to ask, though, like, depending on how you grew up, right, you don't necessarily know that. You think that you have to earn love, right?
Love is not earned, brother. Okay. You're right, because in the way, again, like, you give it how you get it normally. And I think that you made another good point. The best way to receive love is to give it. Like, if you ever feel unloved, if you ever feel like, that's like a cheat code that I have in life. Whatever I lack, I give.
You serve. Yeah.
And
it comes back eventually. Yeah.
Yeah. It's law.
Yeah. It's law. It's just,
when I'm depressed,
just what it is.
Right. That's the way to work through it.
Yeah.
Definitely. Yeah. I concur about this idea of whatever I lack, I give. The thing that I'm learning about love is that it's when we have conversations about the person, we get into the person. But love is greater than the person. Love is greater than any of us. It's expansive. Sure. And we envelop love. We experience love. But so the first time I saw Felicia, she cannot definitively. What I saw in her that day wasn't nearly as powerful as the love I've come to know. Mm-hmm. So it's not the person. It's the two people choosing to govern themselves according to this law. And it helps really well when both people can communicate that nothing is greater than love. So here's our mark. And this is how we will treat each other according to what love governs, not according to how we feel. And if you should treat me outside of the governance of love, how I respond to you when you treat me unfavorably also matters a great deal, right? Mm-hmm. Because if it is truly love, then for me to be, to accuse or to point out when you didn't love me a way that I needed to be loved, right? That would be misrepresenting love. So there's a grace. I think when we talk about this concept about love, we're actually talking about like this grace that none of us truly can understand or comprehend how we receive it. It's greater than anything we could ever ask, but it is there, it is perfect. Because love will also show up in grief. But no one's talking about, like, yeah, when was the first time you saw that grief? You know what I mean? How did you know? There's nothing attractive about talking about grief. Mm-hmm. But when you learn about grief, it teaches you so much more about what love's power is.
Yes.
So now I have a deeper respect for anybody who's even trying to practice love. And I just have grace for people who are trying to experience it, trying to articulate it, searching for it. Like, I actually truly love and respect the pursuit of it, because everybody's trying with these flawed systems, these flawed experiences.
Man, I'm listening to y'all talk about love and all of these things that love represents to you, and I'm just, I guess I'm jaded to a degree. Both of my parents have been married 3 times. I saw a lot of relationship instability. So in my estimation, love is mercurial. That's the element that I would describe it as. Like, it's mercury, and it's, the spectrum is so wide. I've seen love fill a house with light, and I've seen love have the police in front of the house. I've seen the entirety of the spectrum. And so for me, like, it freaks me out at this stage in life to try to submit to love. Mm-hmm. Because I don't know what it'll do to me, ultimately.
You know, and it's safe to say you have to be willing to cut those generational cords. You have to be willing to cut those toxic cords. You have to be willing to cut those things. Because if not, those things, that toxicness, okay, will shift over into your life, passed down from generation to generation. And it does have to be talked about. You know, it does. I remember having a conversation with my mother, asking her, what was her childhood like? You know, why she did the things that she did. You see what I'm saying? And I remember my mother telling me she was never taught how to be a mother. Son, will you please forgive me for the things that I've done to you? I said, Mom, I forgive you and I love you. Because I was going through a rough time. 2019, 2020, 2021, 2022 was rough. It was rough. When I tell you, I thank the mighty Lord, Yeshua HaMashiach, that I did not snap. I'm so thankful and grateful that I did not snap of the things that I was hit with. But I will say this, you never know who God gonna put in your life. You never know the type of angels he will put in your life at the time that you need it most. Until then, shalom. Go be the best version of yourself. One.